الحمد لله رب العالمين، الذي لا عز إلا في طاعته، ولا فلاح ولا نجاح إلا في التذلل لعظمته. هو الله الذي إذا أطعناه شكر، وإذا عصيناه وتبنا إليه تاب وغفر. هو الله الذي إذا دعوناه أجاب، وإذا عاملناه أثاب. سبحانه من إله حكم عدل، قلوب عباده إليه مفضية، وسرهم لديه علانية. الغيب لديه مكشوف، وكل أحد إليه ملهوف. عنت الوجوه لنور وجهه، ودلت الفطر على امتناع مثله وشبهه. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، إلها واحدا أحدا جل عن الشبيه والنظير. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، وصفيه من خلقه، وأمينه على وحيه، وحبيبه وخليله. بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة، ونصح الأمة، وكشف الله جل وعلا به الغمة، وتركنا على محجة بيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. فما أكرمه عبدا وسيدا، وما أبهره أصلا ومحتدا. صل اللهم عليه وعلى آله غيوث الندى، بصلاة وسلام دائمين من اليوم إلى أن يبعث الناس غدا. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي: يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. وبعد، اتقوا الله عباد الله في السر والعلن، وفيما ظهر وفيما بطن، فإن تقوى الله عز وجل هي الوصية في الأولين وفي الآخرين، وهي خير زاد نلقى به رب العالمين. وصانا ربنا عز وجل بالتقوى في محكم التنزيل، فقال عز من قائل: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته، ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة، وخلق منها زوجها، وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا، يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. ما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وأحسن الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وما قل وكفى خير مما كثر وألهى، وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. ثم أما بعد، أيها المسلمون عباد الله، My brothers and sisters in Islam, the month of Shawwal is coming to remind us with the incident of Banu Qaynuqa. We all knew that our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam migrated from Mecca to Medina and established the first Islamic country alayhi salatu wasalam. And the first thing he did عليه الصلاة والسلام, he built his masjid صلى الله عليه وسلم. He reached settlement between Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj. And he عليه الصلاة والسلام established peace and brotherhood between the immigrant, المهاجرون, and the supporter, الأنصار, Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj. So the society in Medina became a peaceful society, and he did not forget to establish peace with the non-Muslims. when our Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام came to Medina, he found the tribe of Al-Aws from the Arab, the tribe of Al-Khazraj from the Arab, and three tribes from the Jewish community, Banu Qaynuqa, Banu Nadir, Banu Qurayza. And far at the north of Medina, there is the gathering of the Jewish people in Khaybar. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam established a treaty with them, peace treaty with them, alayhi salatu wasalam. He offered them peaceful coexistent agreement. So the Muslims and the non-Muslims together are obligated to defend their country, the sacrifice for the safety of their country. If Medina is facing any danger, the Muslims and the non-Muslims must stand together, spend together, sacrifice together to defend their city. And subhanallah, all the Jewish or the three Jewish tribes in Medina signed the agreement with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Banu Qaynuqa, this specific tribe, used to work as businessmen. They own the market of gold. If you want to buy gold or sell gold, you have no place except the Jewish market in the tribe of Banu Qaynuqa. And this tribe, after they signed the agreement, they did not respect the agreement. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam kept receiving reports that the tribe of Banu Qaynuqa are insulting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, insulting Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, speaking ill of the Muslims, trying to destroy the reputation of Islam and the Muslims, trying to create conflict between Muslims and non-Muslims. He kept hearing that, alayhi salatu wassalam. And the big test was the battle of Badr. After 2 years from migration, from the migration of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and specifically, as we all knew, in the month of Ramadan, Quraysh came to conquer the city of Medina with intention to end the existence of Islam and to kill Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and those who believed in him. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised his Prophet victory. Yes, the amount of the soldiers of Quraysh used to be huge when you compare that to the amount of Muslim soldiers. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted the Muslims a victory, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Banu Qaynuqa, before the battle of Badr, were waiting for the defeat of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Muslims, waiting for Quraysh to get the job done. And when the confrontation happened during the month of Ramadan, none of them spent anything, none of them participated in the defense of Islam or in the defense of their city, their own country, the city of Medina. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam returned back to Medina with victory, celebrating the victory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he granted him. But Banu Qaynuqa were very sad because Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the believers won the war. So Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, when he heard that, and you will find this narration in Sunan Abi Dawood, narrated by Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, it is mentioned that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam visited them in their market area alayhi salatu wasalam, and he told them, Ya ma'ashara Yahud, O Jewish people, became Muslims before Allah, become Muslims before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punishes you as he punished Quraysh. I swear by Allah, I am the messenger of Allah,
I swear by Allah that you find me the messenger of Allah in your book. If you read in your own book, you will find me the messenger of Allah. So accept Islam before it's too late, before Allah punishes you as he punished the Quraysh. So they spoke to him in return with arrogance, and they said, Ya Muhammad alayhi salatu was salam, la yaghurrannaka annaka qatalta unasan la ya'rifuna al-harb. Don't be deceived because you won a war against people have no experience about war. فَإِنَّكَ لَوْ قَاتَلْتَنَا لَعْلِمْتَ أَنَّا نَحْنُ النَّاسِ وَأَنَّكَ لَمْ تَلْقَ مِثْلَنَا. Know that if you fight us, you will find us the people. You will find that you never fought people like us. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam understood that these people are not loyal to their agreement with the president of their own country. They have no loyalty to the country, and they are not willing to fulfill their duties toward this agreement and toward this country. The Prophet took it as if they are declaring war against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the believer. So he went back alayhi salatu wasalam, thinking what he should do with them. And later on, Ibn Hisham, in his book of Sirah, narrated that a woman, Muslim woman, wanted to sell piece of gold in the market of the Jewish people of Bani Qaynuqa. So when she went there, while she was selling and talking about the deal, few men came around her, flirting, asking her to uncover herself to show her beauty. She refused. So one of them came from the back and he took the bottom of her clothes, tightening the clothes with her khimar. So when she stood up, her awra was exposed. She kept screaming, radiallahu anha, until a Muslim man was walking by. When he saw what happened, he entered the market area and he started to fight these people. All of them came against him. And what is the result? The result that he was able to kill the man who did this to the sister, and all of them came together and killed this Muslim brother. And you can imagine, it may turn to be a civil war in Medina. Only 2 years after the migration of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even few weeks after the victory of Badr, it is not even a month. And then Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he heard about that, he sent it to them to send the killers, those who insulted the Muslims, those who insulted the Muslim woman, and exposed her body, uncovered her body, and those who killed the Muslim man. The Prophet ﷺ asked this tribe to send them to surrender these people to the justice system of the Muslim country. But the Jewish people refused. And they said to Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, we will fight. And they put in front the 300 soldiers with their swords and shields, backing them by 400 people. They started to line up themselves and to put themselves in rows. So Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, he blockaded them. He put his soldiers around the area of Bani Qaynuqa. This started about 28 days from the Battle of Badr, less than a month. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam put them under siege for 15 days, giving them a chance. They are refusing to be Muslims and to believe in what was written in the Torah, what they found in the Torah, if they are not willing to honor the Torah themselves, and if they are not willing to surrender the killers and those who violated the law, he will fight them, alayhi salatu wassalam. And during these 15 days, they did not agree. They did not accept to surrender the killer or even to honor their own Torah and to accept Islam. You know what happened? Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, who was just became Muslims few days ago. This man, until the Battle of Badr, was kafir. And he was waiting also for the Muslims to be defeated and for Islam to be ended in Medina. And when Prophet Muhammad ﷺ came victorious with the believers, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul decided to become Muslim because he wanted to have some privileges. He wanted to enjoy the victory of those who are victorious. He wanted to be treated as a leader, community leader, because he was a community leader in the tribe of Al-Khazraj. So he became Muslim faking it. So Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, his way is to accept the Islam of everyone. Say, I'm Muslim. If you say I'm Muslim, he will accept it from you. If you say La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he will accept it from you. Even if it is fake from inside, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not tell him to judge the hearts of people. He only judged what people say and what people do. So he accepted what Abdullah ibn Ubay said. Just a few days after he became Muslim, he came to speak in behalf of Banu Qaynuqa. He said, O Messenger of Allah, let them go. These people used to be my people. I used to have a good relationship with them. They used to defend me every time I am at risk. So I'm asking you to let go. The Prophet told him no. Until he came in front of everybody and put his hand in the bucket of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and told him, O Messenger of Allah, I'm not taking my hand out of your clothes until you let go. Let them go. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam asked him to go to speak to them. Tell them to honor their own Torah. If they don't want to honor the Torah, honor their agreement with us. And then they should surrender the killer and the man who insulted the Muslim woman in the market area. Because the Prophet knew, if you let go today, tomorrow it will be worse and it will be bigger. And this is exactly what happened. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul kept pressuring until Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam agreed for two things. For them to leave their weapons inside Medina, and then to leave Medina, all of them, to Azru'at al-Sham, where they came from originally. So you can say the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam accepted that these people travel without weapon and to be deported to Azru'at al-Sham, where they came from. So it was the exile of Banu Qaynuqa tribe from the city of Medina. So my brothers and sisters in Islam, this incident happened in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions, and it is reported for us to learn the lessons. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed it to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam after these people told him, you won the war against Quraysh because Quraysh has no experience about war. If you fight us, you will see that you are fighting the people. You will see that you never fought people like us. So Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed it to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam two verses in Surah Ali Imran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed it to Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam, قل للذين كفروا ستغلبون وتحشرون إلى جهنم وبئس المهاد. O Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam, say to those who disbelieve, you will be defeated and you will be resurrected, you will be gathered together to hell. Wretched a place to be in. Wretched destination to end in. قل للذين كفروا ستغلبون وتحشرون إلى جهنم وبئس المهاد. الله said سبحانه وتعالى قد كان لكم آية في فئتين التقتا، فئة تقاتل في سبيل الله وأخرى كافرة يرونهم مثليهم رأي العين والله يؤيد بنصره من يشاء إن في ذلك لعبرة لأولي الأبصار. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying قد كان لكم آية في فئتين التقتا. See this sign, see this proof. When you saw these two group of people fighting us, the first group was fighting for the cause of Allah and the other group was a group of kuffar. You can see by your own eyes that the amount of the kuffar used to be double and more than double the amount of the Muslims. But Allah grants victory to whomever He wills. And this is a reminder to the people of vision. If you really have vision, if you are people of reason, if you understand, you will know that victory did not happen because of the Muslims and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The victory happened because of the power of Allah. Allah granted His victory to the Muslims, and He grants His victory to whomever He wills, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you oppose Allah and His messenger and the believers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will defeat you. This is the message of the two verses that revealed because of Bani Qaynuqa. And now, my brothers and sisters, you can see after this incident when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not fight them, the tribe of Banu Nadir also planned to do something to the Prophet and the believers. And the tribe of Banu Qurayza did after that. You can see that when Banu Qaynuqa violated the agreement, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam accepted the intercession of Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, and he did not punish any other Jewish tribe. He was limiting the deportation to those who violated the peaceful coexistence agreement with him عليه الصلاة والسلام. To see to which level he is fair عليه الصلاة والسلام. He did not let go completely because he knows صلى الله عليه وسلم, if you let go a small problem, their next problem will be bigger. And you can see that happen in our era. When the Muslims saw Jewish people from Brooklyn and Jewish people from England and Jewish people from France, Jewish people from Germany and from all over the world are traveling to Palestine, nobody did anything about it, they let go. Then when they announced or declared the existence of their country on the land of the Muslims in Palestine, the Muslims were negotiating two countries from the border of 1948. And after what happened in 1967, which you call the Naksa or Nakba, call it whatever you want, the Muslims after that started to negotiate two states up to the border of 67. Now, the Muslims are negotiating two states up to the border of the wall. As much as you give, they will take. As much as you accept, they pressure for more. And their goal is to build a state from the middle of Iraq to the middle of Egypt. From Al-Furat in Iraq to the river of the Nile River in Egypt. It is mentioned at the door of their Knesset. It is mentioned at the door of their parliament. Your kingdom, O David, from Al-Furat to the Nile River. If you can stand in front of their parliament, you will see that the great Israel from the river of Al-Furat in Iraq to the river of Nile in Egypt. Not only that, they want to go deeper up to Medina of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to claim the city of our Prophet and the sacred land of Medina and the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam if they are able. They will go north, they will swallow Jordan and Lebanon and part of Syria. All that to make their great kingdom that they are dreaming of. They are able to win steps. They are able to steal lands and to swallow more lands. But this is in the hand of Allah. When He says enough is enough, it will stop. And when He sees people deserve His victory, He will grant them victory. When we as Muslims deserve the victory of Allah, Allah will grant us His victory. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. The problem is not Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah promised to grant His victory to those who deserve His victory. So if we are not victorious, we should not blame the qadr of Allah. We should not blame other than ourselves, because we do not deserve a victory yet. It is the reality. As long as we and them eager for dunya, the Muslims and the Jews, what is the difference? They are looking for money, we are looking for money. They are looking for power, we are looking for power. They think dunya, we think dunya. They do riba, we do riba. They do zina, we do zina. They fabricate in their deen, and we have imams and scholars fabricating in Islam openly and publicly. We see them and we hear them. When they change the words and the meaning of the words, and they play games and they dodge like fox, we are seeing it. That's why we don't deserve yet, unfortunately. And the solution is to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The solution is to learn our deen, authentic knowledge, the knowledge of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companion, to stick to the foundation of this religion, to the fundamentals of Islam, to care only about the pleasure of Allah, to care only about our meeting with Allah in the last day. When we do so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant us the victory that He granted His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions back then. When He granted them victory against Quraysh, granted them victory against Bani Qaynuqa, granted them victory against Bani Nadir, granted them victory against Bani Quraidah, all those who deceived the Muslims, transgressed against Muslims, the Muslims were able to defend themselves against them. And Allah granted the Muslims victory. So we need to wake up and to know that without Allah, nothing will work for us. Nothing. Without Allah, nothing will work for us. Without repenting, without being upon monotheism, worshipping Allah according to authentic knowledge, taking away our personal desires, our personal opinions, and implementing Islam the way it is revealed, the way it was revealed, the way Prophet Muhammad taught it to his companions, the way his companions implemented the deen, and their implementation was approved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no victory before that. There is no victory without that. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروا إنه سميع قريب مجيب. الحمد لله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله
اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارِك على عبدك ونبيك محمد. أما بعد, my brothers and sisters in Islam, the first thing we need to keep in mind and to take home from this khutbah is that Muslims always offer peace. Our Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, when he lived 13 years in Mecca leading a small minority of people, he was peaceful. And the non-Muslims were not peaceful. And when he migrated from Mecca to Medina and established the first Muslim country, he offered peace, peaceful coexistence agreement. So keep this in mind, that the Muslims always offer peace. They'd never started anyone, any country, any tribe, any group of people with violence. Never happened in the history of our Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. If you study his forays, if you study his expeditions, if you study his wars صلى الله عليه وسلم, he is whether defending the Muslims from attack already happened or trying to start before they start. When he has news and information, proved information that his enemies are preparing for him. Every single time he prepared for war as president of country, it was because his enemy is transgressing against him or about to do that. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So keep this in mind. Don't ever forget that we as Muslims, we offer peace always first. Number two, as Muslims, we need to be always prepared to defend ourselves. Because as long as we are weak, as long as we are divided, as long as we are ignorant, every nation will take advantage of us. When the Muslims were strong, every nation respected us. The kings of Europe used to send their kids to study in Spain, in the Islamic universities. Used to send their kids to work in the Islamic land. Read your history from authentic source. You will see that the Muslims used to be the biggest and the greatest empire on earth. Every single country on earth used to respect Muslims and to seek knowledge in the country of Islam. But nowadays, because we don't have what our grandfathers used to have, we are not united, we are not educated, we are not faithful, we are not people of strong iman anymore. So that's why every single country is taking advantage of us. Don't be amazed when you hear that France occupied Tunisia for 130 years. Don't be surprised when you hear that France occupied the land of Algeria and the land of Morocco more than 100 years in Algeria. More than 100 years. In Egypt, France, and then England. These countries occupied Egypt first, and after the Egyptian resisted, the other country came to occupy, to steal the wealth, to steal the land, to kill innocent, to kill civilians, to destroy educational institutions, to disrespect the religion, because we are weak and divided and uneducated. This is the reality, because our relationship with Allah is weak, because we are not following the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why they are doing that. That's why they are occupying Palestine until now. They did before. The Crusaders did before. And when the Muslims repented, Allah fulfilled His promise to them. And Salah ad-Din al-Ayyubi was able to end the existence of the Crusaders in the Muslim land.
When the Tatars came and occupied the Muslim land in the time of weakness, in the time of ignorance, what happened when the iman was weak? They occupied our land. What happened when we repented? What happened when we found a good leadership like Qutuz? The Muslims won and ended the presence of the Tatars and the Mongols in their land. And nowadays, we can watch the news every single day and see our Muslim brothers are getting killed, living under siege without food, without water, without medication. Their houses are getting destroyed. Their hospitals are getting destroyed. Their masajid are getting destroyed. Their market areas are getting destroyed. They are living completely in a desert and not even safe after all that. They are living in tents waiting for a bullet or a missile to end their life at any time. And 1.5 billion Muslims not able to do anything about it, because everybody is worried about his own house, his own salary, his own future on earth. But no one is thinking of his future after death. The lesson that we need to learn and take home with us, my brothers and sisters, the jealousy of the Muslims, the jealousy of the Muslims. This man who was walking in the market area of Banu Qaynuqa, and he saw his sister under attack. Somebody is trying to uncover her hijab. He did not watch the drama as we do. He did not watch the movie. No, he engaged with them in a fight for the protection of his sister in Islam. And this is what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam praised in his hadith. You know what is jealousy? The jealousy that I'm talking about, Imam an-Nahhas said, this jealousy is a feeling that Allah placed in every man to protect his females from every danger, from every shameful thing, from every immoral thing. So Allah placed this feeling in you as a man to protect your females from any attack, from any immoral or shameful action. This is feeling placed on you, part of your fitrah, your natural inclination. And in Islam, when you sacrifice to protect your honor and the honor of your females, it is considered jihad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes it. In hadith reported in Musnad Ahmad, narrated by the Imams of As-Sunan except Ibn Majah. Hadith in Sunan Abi Dawood, Sunan al-Tirmidhi, Sunan al-Nasai in Musnad Ahmad, narrated by Sa'id ibn Zayd radiallahu anhu. He said, Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet alayhi wa sallam said, Sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. He said, Man qutila duna deenihi fahuwa shaheed. ومن قتل دون دمه فهو شهيد ومن قتل دون عرضه فهو شهيد ومن قتل دون ماله فهو شهيد. If you're standing up to defend your deen, to defend your life, to defend your honor and your females, to defend your money and wealth, and you lose your life, you are a martyr. You will be rewarded as martyr. You achieve the martyrdom. Yes, the Prophet said that, alayhi salatu wasalam, in authentic hadith. In another hadith reported in Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, and in other books of Sunnah, narrated by Al-Mughir ibn Shu'bah. Mughir ibn Shu'bah said, سَمِعْتُ سَعْدَ بْنَ عُبَادَةَ يَقُولُ I heard Sa'd ibn Ubadah saying, لَوْ رَأَيْتُ رَجُلًا مَعَ امْرَأَتِي لَدَرَبْتُهُ بِالسَّيْفِ غَيْرُ مُصَفِّحِ. If I saw a man with my wife, I will hit him with my sword with the edge of my sword. Why? Because the people in the past, if they hit with other than the edge, they don't mean to kill, they mean just to hit, using it as a stick. But if they're gonna use the edge, he's taking the one who is violating him. So Al-Mughir ibn Shu'bah knew it is haram in Islam to kill. It is a major sin. So he wondered, how Sa'd ibn Ubadah say that? He went to Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and say, O Messenger of Allah, I heard Sa'd ibn Ubadah saying such and such. The Prophet said, are you wondering from the jealousy of Sa'd? Wallahi, I have jealousy more than Sa'd. My jealousy is greater than the jealousy of Sa'd. And Allah's jealousy is greater than his servants. Allah's jealousy, yes. It is reported in Sahih Bukhari, narrated by Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu. He narrated that Prophet Muhammad said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغَارِ. In the narration of Muslim, وَإِنَّ الْمُؤْمِنَ يَغَارِ. And also, the believer feels jealous. Then he explained about Allah. He said, وَإِنَّ غَيْرَةَ اللَّهِ أَنْ يَرْتَكِبَ الْمُؤْمِنُ مَا حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. It makes Allah jealous for himself. When you violate his law, when you disobey him, when something happened to those who believed in him and those who are loyal to him, so he subhanahu wa ta'ala is jealous. And when you hear about any of the attributes of Allah, don't compare Allah's attributes with the attributes of his slaves. Allah is completely different. ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we believe in what he said about himself and what his prophet said about him, but we are not comparing Allah to his creation. We don't know how the attributes of Allah. It is at, it befits His Majesty subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the one who has no jealousy is called in Islam the youth. And hadith reported in Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, narrated by Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. He said that Prophet Muhammad said alayhi salatu wassalam, thalathatun la yanzuru Allahu ilayhim yawm al-qiyamah wa la yuzakkihim wa lahum adhabun aleem. Three types of people. Allah will not look at them in the day of judgment. He will never praise them or praise any of their actions. And they will face a severe punishment. Who are they? Losers. The Prophet said alayhi salatu wassalam, al-mar'atu al-mutarajjilah wal-aqqu liwalidayhi والديوث الذي يقر الخبث في أهله. He said, المرأة المترجلة, the woman that behaves like a man, speaks like a man, walk like a man, look like a man, act like a man, Allah will never look at this woman in the day of judgment. He will never praise her action and she will be punished. Also the one who is undutiful to his parents, not respecting those who was reason and causes for his existence. He's not appreciated them. He's not thankful to them. Allah will not look at him, will not praise his action, and he will punish him as a severe punishment. And also at the youth, the man who has no jealousy. Do you know what they call him? Nowadays, they change the bad words to good words. So they don't call wine alcohol, they call it champagne. Any other name that makes people drink it. Beer. Right? So same thing when it comes to the youth, it's a bad word. So how they change that? They say open-minded person. He's an open-minded person. So he can offer his wife to his friend, no problem. He can see his wife half naked, dancing in a wedding, and he's clapping for his wife while she's dancing in front of hundreds of men, half naked. No problem. He has no negative feeling inside him. He's not burning from inside because he's dead. His iman is dead. His iman is weak. So weak. If it's not dead, it's so weak. It has no effect. He's not a man. Because if he's man, his manhood will make him stand for himself, for his own honor, to discipline his females and to educate them and to protect them. You are not open-minded. You are not easygoing man. You are not good person when you allow your female to do that, as long as you have a way to stop them. If you are not, if you don't have, at least feel bad. Because this is the minimum amount of iman. The Prophet said عليه الصلاة والسلام, in hadith reported in Sahih Muslim, narrated by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri رضي الله عنه, if you see something immoral, if you see something evil, stop it by hand. If you are not able, speak against it. If you are not able, hate it by your heart and leave. hated by your heart and leave. If you have no control over your wife and your wife is refusing to wear hijab, rejecting the legislations of Allah and the guidance of Allah, if she's abusing you, if she's threatening you, you have no need to stay in marriage like this. From this platform, you always encourage people to marry. We always encourage people to be patient and to fix their marriages. And when they come to the masjid, we do our best to reach a settlement and to keep husband and wife together. But not to this level. Not to this level. If you have a woman walk in the street half naked, you need to do something about it. And to step out of this relationship. If your wife is not praying, she doesn't fast, she doesn't care about Islam, she has no place in your house. It is a wrong decision you made in the past, and you need to fix it. We need to learn the lessons. This is not a story that we just narrate, drama to watch. It is narrated for us to learn the lessons and to implement these lessons in our life. So we ask Allah Almighty to return us to our deen, to purify our hearts, to protect our private parts, and to restore the iman in our hearts. Allahumma inna nas'aluka bi asma'ika al-husna wa sifatika al-ula an tuqawwi al-iman fi qulubina wa an tashraha sudurana wa an tahfadha furujana wa an taruddana jami'an ila dinika muraddan jamila. Allahumma inna nas'aluka al-huda wa al-tuqa wa al-afafa wa al-ghina. Allahumma aghfir lana dhunubana ajma'in وهب المسيئين منا للمحسنين. اللهم اغفر لنا ولآبائنا ولأمهاتنا ولعلمائنا ولمن له فضل علينا. اللهم إنا نسألك موجبات رحمتك وعزائم مغفرتك والسلامة من كل إثم والغنيمة من كل بر والفوز بالجنة والنجاة من النار يا عزيز يا غفار يا رب العالمين. اللهم أصلحنا وأزواجنا وأولادنا واجعلنا صالحين مصلحين. اللهم اهدنا ويسر الهدى لنا واهدي أزواجنا وأولادنا واجعلنا هداة مهتدين. اللهم اجعل خير أعمالنا خواتيمها وخير أيامنا يوم لقائك. اللهم أحينا على الإسلام وأمتنا على الإسلام وابعثنا على الإسلام يا رب العالمين وأدخلنا الجنة بسلام. اللهم انصر عبادك المستضعفين في فلسطين. اللهم انصر عبادك المستضعفين في غزة. اللهم كن لهم ولا تكن عليهم يا رب، كن معهم ولا تكن ضدهم. اللهم انصرهم على عدوك وعدوهم. اللهم سدد رميهم واجبر كسرهم. اللهم داوي جرحاهم. اللهم تقبل شهداءهم. اللهم احملهم وأطعمهم واسقهم وداوهم برحمتك يا خير الراحمين. اللهم قاتل الكفرة الذين يصدون عن سبيلك ولا يؤمنون بوعدك ويقاتلون أولياءك. اللهم أنزل عليهم رجزك وعذابك يا إله الحق. اللهم منزل الكتاب مجري السحاب هازم الأحزاب، اهزمهم وانصرنا عليهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم اكفناهم بما شئت. اللهم من أرادنا والإسلام والمسلمين بخير فوفقه إلى كل خير، ومن أرادنا والإسلام والمسلمين بشر فاجعل كيده في نحره، واجعل تدبيره وتدميره، واجعل الدائرة عليه يا رب العالمين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. قوموا إلى صلاتكم يرحمكم الله، أقم الصلاة.